1986, for the first time ever, IndyCars race through the streets of a major Canadian city. Al Unser Jr. makes his presence felt, but loses his lead and any chance of victory when he loses a wing. Red hot, Danny Sullivan is looking for his third consecutive win, but has no clutch and a bad fourth gear. He is easy prey for Bobby Rahal. He takes over with 12 laps left. And the Indy 500 winner runs uncontested the rest of the way to claim the inaugural Molson Indy of Toronto. Wife Debbie celebrates the victory, and so too does the man himself on the winner's podium. The championship racing series then moves to the Michigan International Speedway. But the Mayhem 500 took over 5 hours to complete due to the debris and oil and yellow flags of 7 accidents. Roberto Guerrero, one victim, driving cautiously early. Johnny Rutherford roars around the closing laps at 217 miles per hour just to keep his car in front of Jose Legarza. Mrs. Rutherford gets her chance to celebrate, and at the age of 48, Johnny R is a winner again. Now it's time for another 500 at the Pocono, just 30 miles from the Pennsylvania home of Mario Andretti. His fans come out in force, and he does not disappoint. Mario Andretti wins the 47th race of his illustrious career. Victory also pushes Mario past son Michael into the lead of the overall standings. And the last outing for the Indy cars was Mid-Ohio, with a finish oh so reminiscent of Toronto. 10 laps to go, and leader Danny Sullivan is still looking for that elusive third victory of the season, but it won't happen at Lexington. Again, it is Bobby Rahal who overtakes him and cruises to the checkered flag. But it is consistency, race in, race out, that is rewarded in the standings. Mario Andretti is number one. The 1986 Molson Indy of Montreal. The drivers will not be complaining of the heat today as they attack the tri-oval of Sanair Superspeedway. Here in the Eastern Townships, it is a very cool, very windy day, somewhat overcast. There is also the threat of afternoon showers. Hello again, everybody. Dan Matheson with you. Welcome to another Molson Indy on CTV. We expect a lot of excitement here today. All the best drivers on the circuit are here. Points leader Mario Andretti, Indy 500 winner Bobby Rahal, and the man on the pole, Rick Mears. A lot of excitement, too, because of this track. It is short and very tight. And the man who will be describing all the action for you this afternoon is Ron Roush.
Thank you, Dan. And I want to talk to you a little bit about the machinery you're going to be seeing here this afternoon. These are the same cars that raced at the Indianapolis 500 back in May. 700 horsepower they develop. They are turbocharged and they are fueled by methanol because of its high octane rating. These cars can reach 230 miles per hour, which is about the speed it takes to lift a 747 off a runway. Terrific speeds and terrific power is developed. Now, we're going to be racing 300 kilometers around this very short tri-oval here at Sanair. That's 187 miles, and it means that there are 226 laps. Now, that's all of the technical stuff. There's a very human factor involved here as well, and to get the technical human side of the story, we're going to take you down to the track side now, and here's my cohort, Chris Economaki.
Thanks, Ron. Sanair Superspeedway is unique in many ways. It's one of only two triangular tracks in all of North America, and it's the smallest track on which the Indy cars ever take part, 0.826 miles around, 1.33 kilometers. It's extraordinarily fast, but it's also extremely difficult because it's so small. It's been said it's like putting boxes into a ring that measures only 6 feet square. The problem with Sanair Superspeedway is that because its width, 60 feet, is really not usable. You could put 10 Indy cars side by side on this track at rest. At speed, you must be down here in the groove, and that groove is only about 12 feet wide, less than two Indy cars wide. So the drivers say that if you're not in the right place here, you're in trouble. But when you get out of the groove, up in the gray matter, the car can go where it wants to go, not where you want it to go. Okay, Ron, I'll be back up with you in a matter of moments.
Another important part of racing is the action in the pits, and that's where Jack Arute's going to be patrolling all afternoon. Jack?
Because this racetrack is only 0.8 of a mile in sum, Well, pit stops become even more important than at some other places, and here's why. The pit area starts midway down the second straightaway, and it takes up over one-third of this racetrack. So, when the race cars only go around the track at about 19 to 21 seconds, a stop on the pit road could put you a lap down. All of it will be predicated on how quick you come through this area, get to your pits, get the work done by your pit crew, and get back out on the racetrack. So there will be no room for error. You'll have to mind your P's and Q's, and also do it as quickly and efficiently as possible.
Thanks very much, Jack. Certainly auto racing has developed quite a following in this country, given a big boost in the 70s by the heroics of the late Gilles Villeneuve. Now it is brother Jacques who carries the Canadian colors. But what draws the fans? It's the speed and power, the noise, the danger and the glamour, the spectacle that is IndyCar racing. And we'll have it all for you live here on CTV this afternoon, the 1986 Molson Indy of Montreal.
Along with Chris Economaki and Dan Matheson, this is Ron Roush. We're live at Sanair Superspeedway, Saint-Pie, Quebec. It's about 45 minutes away from the city of Montreal and what they call the Eastern Townships area of Quebec. This is always a very exciting time as they are about ready to start their engines down on pit row.
L'édition de 1986, 225 tours de piste, 21 pilotes. Et c'est Bob Gainey, le capitaine des champions de la Coupe Stanley, des Canadiens de Montréal, qui va dire la traditionnelle phrase. Bob.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
And now you'll get that familiar roar as these big 700 horsepower cars begin to start their engines here at Sanair. Let's take a look now at the grid for today's race. On the pole will be Rick Mears, driving at Sanair for the first time since that terrible 1984 crash that severely injured both feet. Joining him on row one will be Kevin Cogan, currently riding a hot streak. He's been in the top five three of the last four races. Second at Indian Michigan in the 500 milers. There's Bobby Rahal, the only 3-time winner on the kart circuit this year, and joining him on the second row will be Michael Andretti, currently third in the kart standings. On the third row, Michael's dad, Mario. He won the Pocono 500, the final 500-mile race of the year just a couple of weeks ago. And joining Mario, another Formula One champion, Emerson Fittipaldi of Brazil, in a streak of bad luck right now. On the fourth row, another South American, Roberto Guerrero from Colombia. Roberto, in successive Indy 500s, has a second, third, and a fourth. And Danny Sullivan is on row four as well. He has brought glamour to Indy racing with his Hollywood lifestyle image. Tom Sneva, the gas man, on row five. Never count him out on a speed circuit like Sanair. And outside on row five is little Al Unser Jr., third last year here at Sanair. Moving down the grid, on row six is Pancho Carter, another son of a famous motor racing father. On row seven, we look at Jacques Villeneuve of Bergerville, Quebec, 16th in the overall standings this year, along with last year's winner here, Johnny Rutherford. On row eight, it is Derek Daly, the Irishman from Dublin, and the oldest man in kart racing, 52-year-old Dick Simon. Row nine, another son of a famous father, Jeff Brabham, son of Sir Jack of Australia, and rookie Dale Coyne. In row 10, Johnny Parsons, replacing the injured Jose Legarza in car number 55, and also Raul Boisel of Brazil. And our 21st starter at the back of the grid after a crash yesterday in qualifying, Gary Bettenhausen, whose father, Tony, won Indy in 1951 and 58. He was killed there in 1961. The cars are out on the track for their pace laps now. The pace car is on the track as well. Always an exciting moment, Chris.
Well, they're up against a tough racetrack here. It's very, very fast. The turns are very tight. And as Tom Sneva said yesterday, it's an oval track, a speedway, but it has road race corners. You've got to get in line to get around this racetrack. There's a lot of money up, $840,000 Canadian dollars, and important points. Point towards the world, towards the national championship. Here's what the drivers see as they get on the straightaway. What you're seeing now are the cars going back and forth to warm up their tires so they have better adhesive qualities once the race gets underway. Rick Mears and Danny Sullivan and Bobby Rahal don't have to do this. They have electric tire warmers in their pits, so their cars are preconditioned for the race. They're very expensive, and only some of the teams have them. Three straightaways, one extremely fast turn in this triangular course, turn two, which is almost impossible to pass. They say that in order to pass on this racetrack, you have to make up your mind a quarter of a lap or a third of a lap ahead of the actual move out here. That's that difficult.
We'll be, of course, getting that view from inside Jacques Villeneuve's car throughout the afternoon as we have an onboard camera there. And I'll tell you something, when they're at speed, that is a terrific shot. You really get a sense of what the driver's going through out there. There you see the pole sitter in car number one. That's a very familiar car, Rick Mears.
That car is powered by a Chevrolet, special Chevrolet engine that's the only one like it in existence. And it's interesting that car owner Roger Penske is missing the race today. For the first time in more than 10 years, he's not at a race where his cars are entered. He suffered an accident water skiing on vacation last week, tore a hamstring muscle, planned to come and found he couldn't bend his leg to get in his helicopter and had to stay home. We know you're watching, Roger. We hope that things go well for you today and you're feeling better this week.
And Kevin Kogan is also on row number one. And as we look at Rick Mears, that Penske PC15, by the way, is a specially developed car. Jack Arutz down in the pit area right now. Bring us up today, Jack.
There were some close moments prior to the start of this race in the Penske pit with pole sitter Rick Mears. It seems they had an oil line that was suspect. They changed it and only brought the car to the grid about 5 minutes before the gentleman start your engine's command. So that's not what you want to have before the start of the race, but hopefully from the pole position they'll be able to run well. Let's go back upstairs.
We're looking again at Rick Mears in car number one. We should mention that car number one is the designation for the defending kart champion. Al Unser won the kart championship last year, and I think it was a very, very graceful moment at the annual banquet last year at the end of the season when he presented the one back to Rick Mears.
It was a very sporting gesture, and it got a lot of applause for Al. Rick turned the car over to Al at midseason saying, "You got a chance for the championship. I'm here with bad feet. I can only run certain races. Take it, Al." And he did, and he won the title by 1 point over his son.
The pace car is leaving the track now, and we're getting set for what should be the start of this Molson Indy at Sanair. They're down. The green flag is out. Rick Mears is out in front. Kevin Kogan tucking right in behind him, but he's not getting much room as he goes around the turn, has successfully negotiated, and they cruise now down that back straight. And they apparently have gone through it cleanly with the... Oh, they have not. Way back in the corner, we have lost a couple of cars, so they did not negotiate the start cleanly, and a yellow flag is going to come out on the first lap.
It was a case of the drivers having cold tires, Ron, and not getting the fight in the corner. It was a lazy spin on the part of three cars. We see Dale Coyne up there in car number 19. It looks like... Johnny Rutherford perhaps involved, who won the controversial race here last year.
Don't know whether it's Johnny or not. I'm just looking through the field to see if
Rutherford's
I can spot
Rutherford's down
his car.
Low on the inside.
That's Rutherford's car for sure. And up along the upper wall there, as you look at Dale Coyne's car there, that's a Chevy stock block, his own chassis design. He's had an awful lot of grief this year trying to get going. And we also see Jacques Villeneuve quickly into the pit, so he didn't like the way things were handling on his car.
Villeneuve's under an awful lot of pressure. The press is all over him. The newspapers are full of Jacques Villeneuve. He's the favorite here, and he's changing tires.
All right, we're going to get a very interesting view now. This is Jacques Villeneuve's in-car camera. I think we're going to be able to see what happened here, Chris.
Yeah. Okay, there's a car on the outside. Keep your car on the outside. See, he comes down and pinches this car directly in front of us here. The car on the outside realized he had to get down where the groove was, where the car would get a hold, and he cut the second car off, causing the spin.
The car that broke loose there, by the way, was Dennis Firestone. So he was the car that broke loose as the car pinched down from the top. As again, that what Chris pointed out clearly as we look at Jacques Villeneuve's car in the pits, at the outset of the telecast, that narrow groove you have going through the turn.
Now, what's happened to Villeneuve? He's lost a lap. He's been in the pits as the cars come by, so he's under tremendous pressure now to do well here.
There is something underneath that is troubling his crew, and obviously Villeneuve as well. So as they work on Jacques Villeneuve's car and they continue under the yellow, we'll take a break from the Molson Indy at Sanair. We can tell you that Johnny Rutherford has managed to go back onto the track, so he is back in the pack right now and is going to return to racing. And down below, Jack Arute to bring us up to date. Problems with Jack Arute's wireless mics down there. That happens once in a while in this sport. Chris?
Well, it looks as though Johnny Rutherford, who won here last year, is back. He's okay. He's in the field. And Dale Coyne, the only Chevrolet engined car in the race, is also back in the field. Firestone is still trying to get started. He's parked up there on the track. And Jacques Villeneuve has now lost two laps. And if you remember, Villeneuve failed to complete a lap on the track at Toronto either, so he's really having tough luck in his home country.
Now, that is Dennis Firestone, the ambulance down there. There are rules if you've been shaken up in an accident of some sort, and the car itself is being towed off the track. So I would say that the day is over for Dennis Firestone, who finished 14th in 1985 here at Sanair last year. He's a former Formula driver who has not had a great deal of success, and not a great deal of success racing in Indy-type racing. Here's the way the point standings are, and you can see this is a terrific year for the competitive side of kart racing. Mario Andretti just a point ahead of Danny Sullivan, and Michael Andretti just 3 points behind his father with Al Unser Jr. So you have the two sons in there, the two young side of the family right in the race. Al Unser Jr., of course, just missed the championship by 1 point last year to his father in the final race of the year. Bobby Rahal's the only three-race winner so far this year, but he has not been able to translate the three races into a lot of points simply because he's been a little inconsistent in a few DNFs in a couple of other races.
Well, you know, the series has grown tremendously in the amount of prize money that it gets. The PPG, the sponsor of the series, told me this morning that their contributions alone to the money side of kart racing in 1986 will exceed $2 million. Right now, the biggest money winner is Bobby Rahal with $897,000 in the bank with several races to go.
Including a record payoff for Rahal at the Indy 500, where he won over $500,000. That's a pretty nice payday for a couple of laps of racing there as he overhauled Kevin Kogan to win the championship there.
You know, I think one of the remarkable things about today's race, Ron, is the fact that Rick Mears, who was so seriously injured here 2 years ago, this is his first Sanair start since that crash, and he put it on the pole with a new record. So we'll be able to watch Rick Mears take the green flag and after these important messages.
Flagman Nick Fornaro has just dropped the green flag, and they've gone back to racing and opening up a big lead right off the dropping of the flag. Rick Mears, and he is right out in front very quickly, and there's a car that seems to be dropping back and fading, but Mears really got the jump as he got the green flag.
Michael Andretti allowed Kogan to pass him on the outside. I have to say something is wrong with Andretti's car. His father is right behind him. Andretti is third. Andretti's are third and fourth now. And Rick Mears has got a nice lead over Kevin Kogan. So the Chevy engine PC-15 is out in front for the first time in its short career.
PC-15 is the new development. They brought it to Indianapolis in May, hoping to get it into the show there, and just couldn't. They simply uncrated one of those marches, and they went racing with that one. And, of course, Mears wound up finishing third. He was part of that three-way fight at the end of the Indy 500, which was eventually won by Bobby Rahal in those final moments. But there you see the leaders, and you see that yellow car, watch for it, is easily identified as that of Rick Mears, the Pennzoil special.
Kevin Kogan in second place is starting to gain on Mears. Kogan is really running very well in that 7-Eleven car owned by Pat Patrick, and he is inching up on Rick Mears, who's setting the pace here. Meanwhile, the Andretti's son and father lie third and fourth about equal distance. Now Kogan is right on Mears' rear wing.
We're going to have some fun here. Kevin Kogan, a kind of a controversial guy. He always raced for six different teams over the last 6 years, and I think most of the controversy dates back to that starting accident that involved Kogan at the Indy 500. But now we're watching Johnny Rutherford's car slowing down on the back stretch, so we're getting people starting to run into some problems now. Some action in the pits already early in the race, but right now it's a race between Mears in number one and Kogan in number seven.
Beautiful day here in Sanair. The sun's shining. A perfect day for racing engines and for drivers. A little cool for spectators.
And yeah, maybe cool, but they're here, and it's a packed grandstand to watch this one. Mears again with Colgan right on his tail. It's a low-level shot as they whiz by. They pit straight here and into turn one.
It'll be interesting to watch the battle for third place. But Mario Andretti now is right on his son's rear wing and putting the pressure on the boy that he brought along so thoroughly and so skillfully into big-time racing.
Well, we just saw on the turn three of the three turns there are in this tri-oval, we just saw Colgan move right up to the tail with a good grab of the leader, Rick Mears. I think maybe what he's doing is trying to reverse a pass here, which is something that that will happen.
We're back in the pack. Tom Snave, an Indianapolis winner in the green Skoal Bandit car, holding off the charges of Jose Lee, of Roberto Guerrero in the True Value number two car there, learning this racetrack. It's Sneva who said that this is really a unique track, as we mentioned earlier. It's a speedway, but it has road racing corners. You do have to get in line. Yet there are some who say that before this day is over, somebody will accomplish an outside pass at speed. The cars are getting that much better.
Well, Sneva might be one of those guys who could do it. If there's anybody in traffic that will do something unorthodox on a circuit like this, it's Tom Sneva. You have to remember that Tom last year started at the back of the pack here at Sanair and wound up in seventh place. He is, they call him the gas man. He loves to race, and quite often, Chris, you like to talk about the difference between us. Johnny Rutherford, you can see him slowing up there, and he is being passed. It's also the pass there of Dale Coyne, who's back out on the track as well. Here's Jack Arute.
Dennis Firestone has been taken to here, the mobile medical unit from the Horton safety team. They've looked him over, and the initial prognosis is that he has a problem, possibly a separation of his shoulder. It's swelled up, and they're taking him through all the precautionary measures at this time. But he's awake, conscious, very upset that he's out of the race, but actually okay.
We're getting a pretty good battle going on here for fourth place as Bobby Rahal has moved up now to challenge Mario. So there's five cars right together there now, all on the back stretch, and I'll tell you, any one of them could be leading this race in three or four laps.
I'm just going to check here. The first five cars crossed the starting line inside of a second, exactly 1 second, and Colgan, his car is running better on the straightaway. Now, Michael Andretti tries to go under Kevin Colgan in turn two, can't quite make it, and give an opening for his father. That's what one little slip can do for you. Instead of gaining a position, he lost a position.
To his father, who is back past Michael and into third place. So right now, we've got Colgan in second place behind Mears, then Mario, then Michael Andretti, and then Rahal. So there's a terrific battle going on for the lead right now. A five-way battle. The whole five separated on an official count at 1.0 seconds.
Okay, now the battle is going to be Mears has got traffic directly in front of Mears. There's Rahal putting the pressure on Michael Andretti for fourth place as Mears goes into traffic.
Now they're now into the traffic.
And Michael's going to pass his father again.
Tried to, and I think he has stood him off there, but there's going to be some interesting shuffling going on right now. There's Michael, and Michael is the one in front of that picture, and I think there was Rahal behind him.
Right, Colgan almost got by Mears for the lead, and look, Colgan has dropped three positions on one straightaway in traffic. Shows you what the traffic will do to a driver. Colgan dropped from second to fourth in one straightaway because he made the wrong move behind a slower car.
And Mario's now got the pressure on Mears.
Right, and followed by Michael, and Mario goes underneath Mears, and boy, what a driver, and what a car that's handling.
Watch Michael, he's going to try him too on the straightaway now. He got a good line going into the turn, and Michael's going to get Mears as well.
Daddy, I'm right behind you, he's telling him.
The key pass, the key to the whole thing was the pass, or at least the line he took in corner three that set up corner one.
Now it's developing here that it's standing there. Turn three is the key turn where you can pass on. See, this has not been the case. The car's a little different this year, and now they're finding out that turn three is the key to success today.
So right now, it is Andretti. Up on top is Mario. Son Michael is second, and in third place is Kevin Colgan now, and dropping all the way back to fifth is Rick Mears. Down below, Jack Arute. Some more problems with Jack Arute's microphone, and we'll pick it up once again as we continue to watch the leader, Mario Andretti. And now Michael Andretti has moved up into the first place, second as Mario now, according to our track statistics here, has now dropped on down to third place.
Oh, and exactly, and Emerson Fittipaldi has just passed Rick Mears and Al Unser Jr. Tom Sneaver, the minute the traffic gets thick, he seems to go faster. It just appears to be that way. He loves the cut and thrust.
So we'll review the leaders then. Michael Andretti has the lead, followed by car number three, which is Bobby Rahal in second place, 1.2 seconds behind right now. And in, now just correct that, because the shuffling Mario has moved back into second place. So this is just back and forth. Now Mario, then Michael. And there you see that they're in your picture right there.
It's a family affair at the front of this race at Sanair, with the father leading the son, and Bobby Rahal, last year's winner, hanging right in there in third place, and coming up behind Derek Daly, the Irishman, who moves over like a gentleman and lets them through on the inside. At least he lets Mario through. He's going to decide if he's going to let any more through.
I think he's got the other one to let through, too, Michael. Well, he shut Michael down in that flat-out area in the back end of the tri-oval. So it is now Mario, Michael. And then in third place is Bobby Rahal at this moment. And in fourth place is Kevin Cogan. And we're beginning to lose the car of Rick Mears, who's dropped down to eighth place now. And that Penske PC15 is still in the development stages and apparently not very reliable at all, although the pole sitter.
You know, in the four races, it started seventh at Phoenix, finished 11th, started ninth at Long Beach, finished 20th, started 15th, and he finished 11th, and started 20th at the Meadowlands and finished 19th, and has yet to finish a race.
All right, the leaders right now, Roberto Guerrero is the leader right now. So now we've got Roberto Guerrero in front ahead of Michael Andretti. Down below, once again, here's Jack Arruth.
Here's the problem on Rick Mears, your pole sitter. He began to drop back. They thought he had a serious push to the car. But now they think he may have a tire going down. So Roger Penske has called Rick Mears into the pits. This is definitely an unexpected pit stop. He should be making his presence known here on pit road. Right behind me, he's coming to a stop.
They have the first pit there.
We'll go to work, checking out what tire may be wrong. You can see the blisters on the right front tire. It is blistered badly, and that is very indicative of probably a serious handling problem. Not a tire being cut, but rather blistered. He's off and away. Let's go back topside.
So Rick Mears back at it again. They have the first pit area right off the entrance of the pit lane. So he has to go negotiate the whole pit lane and then get back out onto the circuit. So let's update you then. The leader at this moment is Mario. In second place is Michael Andretti. And in third place is Bobby Rahal. We'll be back to the Molson Indy in a moment. Back at the Molson Indy at Sanair, and there's the battle for the lead, and there are three cars right there, one, two, three, separated by exactly 1 second. The leader is Mario Andretti, second is his son Michael, and third is Roberto Guerrero of Colombia, who has moved right into it. One moment there, he actually had the lead there and then lost it quickly to Mario again, but he has suddenly put himself into the picture again. Guerrero from Medellin in Colombia. At Sanair last year, he was 23rd after starting second. He was on the front row of the grid.
Remember, he led the race last year for a while. He's a very, very accomplished high-speed driver. Rick Mears' pit stop took only 12 seconds when they placed that right front tire. Incidentally, the cars are racing on Goodyear radial tires today. A year ago, they were on Goodyear bias-ply tires. So the radial tires, the drivers say, take some getting used to. They're better, but they act differently than what they're accustomed to. But Yanni Sullivan, last year's Indy 500 winner Rick Mears' stablemate, has fallen a lap off the pace as the Andretti's father and son continue to set a blistering pace on the track, with Roberto Guerrero of Colombia lying third. In fourth place is Bobby Rahal, last year's winner, and lying fifth is Kevin Cogan. In sixth place is Emerson Fittipaldi of the two Patrick Racing Marches.
There are the two Andretti's up on top. So it's Andretti, followed by Guerrero. In fourth place right now is car number three, Bobby Rahal, and then Kevin Cogan. And following Kevin Cogan is the car of Emerson Fittipaldi.
Okay, now the leaders come up against a traffic situation here. The leaders are in traffic, and we may see some position changing now, whether Michael can take advantage of his father's moves, trying to get by the slower car.
Now let's take a look at it.
Guerrero is nosing in there, too.
Well, he had some good draft there, and it looked like he got a little bit of a slingshot, but just couldn't get enough. And Mario got his foot into it and stayed ahead.
And Guerrero goes underneath Michael Andretti going into turn one, but at least makes the effort.
Look took a shot at it. Again, here comes Michael on his father.
You see what happened? Guerrero made an abortive move on Michael Andretti and lost the position to Bobby Rahal.
All right, we're watching the two Andrettis, and Rahal is there as well. But right now, back to Jackaroo.
Oh, Pete.
Teammates Dick Simon and Raul Boisel have had their share of problems. Here's what happened to Boisel early in the race. He tore up the front wings. So his car runner and teammate Dick Simon pulled out of the race, removed the front wings from his car, put them on Raul Boisel's car, and they're back out racing. But let me update you on another concern as well. It's beginning to rain.
That is bad news, of course, because you cannot race on this circuit in the rain. If it gets slightly greasy at all, they will have to halt proceedings. And we have not gone halfway here, which is, of course, an official race.
Well, I think that the rain is only temporary. There's blue skies around this thing. There's a black cloud overhead, and it'll be moving out in a matter of minutes, I would think. Michael Andretti had to lock up the brakes to keep from running into his father just before he went down to talk to Jack. But here's the view from Jacques Villeneuve's car on the main straightaway. The bald tires, bald in the descriptive sense, as opposed to being worn out, just preclude any racing on a wet asphalt raceway. And now all the leaders are making their pit stops, and we'll see. The yellow flag is out for the rain. Mario Andretti now holds the lead. Guerrero is second. In third place will be Roberto Moreno. And then in fourth place will be Rick Mears, because all the other competitors are in the pits getting fresh rubber. That'll shuffle again when they come back out.
Michael Andretti's car right there. Earlier you saw car number three. That's Bobby Rahal. Look at this action. This is a terrific shot now. Pit row, when you've got them all in there, is really something. And why there are not more accidents down there is really hard to understand. But we've got some problems with Andretti here.
All right, they're changing the nose. You see, when he hit, he must have touched his father. When he locked up the brakes, they're replacing. Here we go. Now, here's Michael Andretti on the left, his father, Mariano. Watch the left front tire on Michael's car smoking. Okay, there goes the front wing. You can see he touched the wing. And you know what? This rain is a break for Michael Andretti. He can get in there and get the wing changed without losing too much time. He's going to lose a lap, though. He'll be a lap down when he gets back out, at least one lap, and perhaps two. And Roberto Moreno just drove over a tire coming in the pit, so it's pretty chaotic down there now.
I've always said, you know, when you see this sort of thing on the yellow, when everybody is due for fuel and everything else, Michael is on his way out, and I think he stalled his car. He got it going, and he's underway once again, but coming out. All right, this is another look at the little incident here. Now, Michael's the yellow and blue car.
On the right-hand side of your screen, there's his tire smoking, and he nudged his dad and bent that right front wing. Now, we don't know whether Mario's left rear tire is affected by that brush or not. Mario has not been in for fresh rubber. He's a crapshooter, that Mario Andretti. And that fat black cloud is moving away from over here at the top of Sanair Superspeedway in Saint-Pierre, Quebec.
Well, we're going to have one of those days where we'll get sunlight and then cloud. It's that type of day at Sanair. It's going to be a great race. We'll be back. That is car number 9, Poncho Carter, out there, and he is about to get a stop-and-go penalty for running over that tire. Chris spotted it in the pit area. So after the green flag, which has just been shown, Carter is going to be waved in. He's going to come into the pits. He's going to stop and then start again. It's a penalty, a method of penalizing for a rule infraction in the pit area.
Well, Mario Andretti decided to forego a pit stop on that yellow flag. He retains the lead. Roberto Guerrero is a close second. And flying third now is Johnny Rutherford, who did not do it. Rutherford was involved in that first lap skirmish. But Rutherford's car has not been running too well. Now here comes his stop and go penalty as being displayed in the pits. In, stop, and away he goes again. Yeah, the penalty has now been paid. He's legal once again. Can't run over anything in the pits, parts, tools, air hoses, etc., without incurring the wrath of the officials.
All right, out in front, we have Mario Andretti, followed by Guerrero right now, officially, on the electronic timing that we have here. Johnny Rutherford is third, and fourth is Bobby Rahal. And there you see it. Our leader, the separation is 0.6 seconds between first and second, Mario and Guerrero. And now, some action going in the turn as Mario is beaten through the turn. And now we have a change.
Good action shots here. Gilles Villeneuve, for those of you who are following, Jacques Villeneuve, pardon me, you're following his career. He's parked in the pits again with more work being done on his Canadian tire special. Pace. Lap times here under 22 seconds. Full lap and in less than 22 seconds at racing speed. Last year's winner, Bobby Rahal, flashing by the signs so fast that the signs cannot be made out.
Very, very fast laps and kind of a dizzying pace. And this is one of these circuits, when you talk about motor racing, you talk about total concentration constantly throughout the race. You cannot wool gather even for a split second.
That's right.
The result would be, if you did such a thing, the wall. You have absolutely no opportunity at all. But we've got some tight racing going on here.
Roberto Guerrero just passed Mario Andretti on the inside for the lead. It was a bold inside pass in turn one. And so Roberto Guerrero is where he was a year ago, out in front in the Molson Indy at Sanair.
Well, Roberto Guerrero is a Formula One driver. He came up through the road racing. Many of the drivers who did such have had a lot of trouble in this type of racing. Guerrero is one of those who has adapted very well to the oval racing, seems to like it.
That's right, but don't forget what Sneva said. He said this is an oval track with road racing corners. You use the brakes rather than the brake pedal rather than the accelerator pedal to pass here. And that's exactly what Guerrero did.
Well, Guerrero moving through turn three now and fighting his way past Pancho Carter. And now it's Carter in between number one and number two. Guerrero in front and Mario in second place with the lapped car there of Carter in between them. Up, nope, close to the wall there.
Well, they come very, very close. You've got to use all the racetrack to keep the engine revolutions up. So it's Guerrero, Mario Andretti, and Johnny Rutherford back in the Front American car. Last year's winner here, third place. Moving up fast is Emerson Fittipaldi in car number 20, about a straightaway behind. But you know, Ron, here at Sanair, straightaway interval doesn't mean anything. One little slip and the fella can make a straightaway up on you.
Guerrero has had some success, although he's not a winner. His best finish ever in Indy racing was at the Indy 500 as a rookie. He was second, the 1984 co-rookie of the year with Michael Andretti at Indy. He also had a second at Mid-Ohio in the last race, so he's coming on. He was fourth at Indy this year. We mentioned his success at Indy. He's been very consistent there. His last three Indies, he has had a second, a third, and a fourth. So he hasn't picked up the major headline, but within Indy circles and in this type of racing, he has certainly developed a certain amount of respect.
It's interesting now, Guerrero is being challenged on the track by Kevin Cogan, who's a lap down. Cogan stopped for fresh rubber. It appears as though Cogan may have the fastest car on the track right now. And here we have Emerson Fittipaldi trying to hold off Bobby Rahal for one of the top 10 running positions.
Fittipaldi, those familiar colors, he's carried them for years in motor racing, right back to his days with McLaren. And, of course, he won a world championship with the McLaren people.
Fittipaldi is fourth, and Rahal is fifth on the track right now there on your screen.
And the leader continues to be Roberto Guerrero, followed by Mario Andretti. And inside the car of Jacques Villeneuve. Here's Villeneuve at speed. This is how fast those walls come up on you, and how, you know, if you miss anything, you're into that wall. So
that's
quickly.
Quite a shot. You can see the vibrations and how close they come to the outside wall. That's a great view of the Sanair Superspeedway. All the people up there in the stands now, there's a start finish line, and right away you're down into turn number one here. Come from the outside of the track, way down to the inside of the track, using the full width of the racetrack, 60 feet.
We talk about racing technology. How about television technology? Any camera that has any size at all would destroy the aerodynamics of that car. It is so small, that camera, that they can put it in there and it does not disturb anything. Now we've got a little shuffling going on down on the track again.
All right, is Michael Andretti on the right side of your screen, and little Al Unser, the third car, trying to get by a slower machine. Next time we go back to Jacques Villeneuve's in-car camera, you can watch the how much his neck suffers with the jiggling, that heavy crash helmet. Even though this track is agreed as the smoothest racetrack outside of Indianapolis that these cars race on, you can just see how much vibration is developed by these speeding cars.
Well, that's Michael Andretti and Al Unser Jr. out there, who are very much involved in the hunt for the overall kart championship. If you look at the standings, Andretti, Mario leads with 97 points, but Michael has 94, and Al Jr. is in fourth place with 91. Terrific race, one of the best kart races ever, involving the number of drivers that are involved at the top end of the standings. It's been one of those years where they almost take turns winning. back into the pack a little bit and watch Emerson Fittipaldi go up against Bobby Rahal here. And they currently are racing for fourth and fifth place, and they're separated by 0.2 seconds at this moment. Bobby Rahal, conservative. There's a shot of Emerson Fittipaldi, the veteran. He's now a 39-year-old. He's had a bit of bad luck, finished out of the points his last five straight races. He admits that he's still feeling his way on the ovals, but says he likes it.
Roberto Guerrero is blazing quite a trail out in front. In fact, he's pulling away from Mario Andretti in second place. The battle right now is between Fittipaldi and Rahal for fourth place, and Rahal moves in behind him. That's Dale Coyne. The paint job on Dale Coyne's Chevrolet engine car resembles that of Michael Andretti's quite a bit. And Michael's back on the track with a fully repaired car, but lost an awful lot of ground getting that nose piece replaced that he damaged running into the back of his father's car.
Hey, by the way, these two are starting to move up towards the third place car at the moment. They're less than a second behind car number 21. That's Johnny Rutherford's car. He's the defending champion here. So they are moving right up, trying to put the pressure on Rutherford. You just saw him up ahead, car number 21. So we're going to have a real battle here in a couple of minutes. There's Rutherford's car now. So you see the three of them. Rutherford followed by Fittipaldi and Rahal. And they get into this traffic now. Lone Star JR is going to have some close company.
And Rahal there decided to look at the outside and change his mind when he saw what it looked like. He just nosing around there. But in Fittipaldi's case, he's got to spend as much time looking at the mirror on as he does at the racetrack and the cars in front of him.
Well, right now, they're moving right up there. Rutherford, car number 21. Involved in a very controversial finish last year. Took 3 weeks to decide who won the race here last year. And right now he is in third place, followed by those other two cars who are right close to them. They are racing about 7 seconds behind the leader, who is Roberto Guerrero. In second place is Mario Andretti. Well, those are the standings. 74 of 226 laps gone. We'll be back. Well, you see Roberto Guerrero there, and he is under some pressure once again. Guerrero has lost to first place to Mario Andretti, but then he took it right back again, I think. And so we're going to seesaw back and forth here. It's interesting that staying right in the hunt is Johnny Rutherford. So he wasn't running that well early, but he's now apparently functioning quite well.
Well, Guerrero now is calling at the pits. Whether it's a routine stop or not, 81 laps, that's about 70 miles. This is a routine pit stop. Andretti will have to stop also fairly soon. They're out of sync, so to speak, with several of the other cars who made their stop under the yellow flag.
Mario not stopping under the yellow in the situation. He obviously had to be very happy with the way his car is running.
Well, but he also wanted to keep the race at two pit stops. The ones who stopped on the yellow will have to stop three times before the race is over.
There's been plenty going on down in the pit lane area. Here's Jack Arute.
The litany of bad luck for Roberto Guerrero and the True Value team continues here at Sanair. After leading and running so well here, Roberto Guerrero was forced to pit because he ran out of fuel. Remember, he did not pit early on. Now, pit stops, he ran out of fuel. They had to restart the engine. It was a lot of time on pit road. You can't afford to do that here at an 0.8-mile track.
Kevin Kogan just went by him out there on the track. Number two is, of course, Guerrero. Kogan in car number 7 just whipped right by him as he was trying to bring his car up to speed.
All right, if Guerrero runs out of fuel, that means Andretti is getting close to seeing the needle all the way to the left on his gauge. So Mario Andretti, who's in front right now, is going to have to stop for fuel very soon. They were the only two drivers among the front runners outside of Rutherford who did not stop when the yellow flag waved early.
You know, they talk about how exact the business of putting these cars on a track, the computers that get involved. How in the world can you run out of fuel? it just seems to be a little mind-boggling to me a little bit. Like a little mind-boggling to the guy at home who's got a fuel gauge on his car and a red light comes on when the fuel's down. Anyway, it's Mario Andretti. We'll watch him closely right now as he goes by Dale Coyne. Everybody's been going by Dale Coyne, who is having his problems out there with that Chevy-powered car, which, by the way, has a completely different sound from the Cosworths you hear out there. the stock block Chevy that he uses in that car.
The cars were the Sopranos and the Chevrolet's a Basso Profundo. Well, you know, you saw talk about fuel gauges. The fuel readouts on these cars are not exactly fuel gauges. They're highly sophisticated metering devices that measure how much fuel has gone through the pipe leading to the engine. And they subtract that from what the tank holds. Now, here's Andretti coming in right now. Let's just see how long he spends in the pits. Mir's pit stop for that right front tire was 12 and a fraction seconds. Okay, our watch starts with Brian Andretti up on the hydraulic jacks. Right side rubber being put on, fuel going in, and he's in the pits now 10 seconds, 11 seconds, 12. It's got a slow stop. He's going to fall well more than a lap down. And there he goes, 18.27 seconds. That is a very, very long pit stop by IndyCar standards. He's going to have to drive very hard to make up that extra 6 seconds he spent in the pits.
And it seemed to be the problem the tires were on, but the fuel was slow. They did not disconnect the fuel holes until about the 17-second mark, and that's when they got them going. So our leader right now in front is Bobby Rahal with the fuel stops we've had. Rahal followed by Al Unser Jr. And right behind him is Emerson Fittipaldi in third place. Kevin Colgan is now back up to fourth, and in fifth place is Mario, who got out in fifth, and he is a lap down. So we have only four cars on the single lap, one through four. Kogan's the last of that group. So, and now he's gone a lap down. So there are only three now on the same lap.
Mario's concern right now is to pass Bobby Rahal. If he passes Bobby Rahal, he gets in the same lap, and should a yellow flag come out, he could circle around and get the tail end. But right now, a yellow flag would not help Mario Andretti in this race today. He's got to pass number three directly in front of him.
So Rahal, in car number three, who's the leader, is the man that Mario has his eyes set upon. 1984, Mario finished in seventh place. Last year he was 15th. He's had some bad luck this year, but he has got some great machinery and has over the last couple of years, and of course leads the series.
You know, it's interesting, the predominance of British machinery. The Indianapolis 500 on this year, for the first time in its history, did not have an American-made car. Every car in the Indy 500 this year was made in England. Here's Michael Andretti making his second pit stop, heading into the pits now. And this is going to put him further down. He should be able to go further. This must be for adjustment reasons or tire. Right front tire. Apparently, this racetrack, if the chassis is not exactly right, you're going to have problems with the right front tire. They call that a push or plowing. Actually, the proper term is understeer. You turn the wheels and the car doesn't want to turn, and it scrapes on the right front corner here. Look at him light up the tires getting out of the pits there. He's really a young hot shoe. He announced this morning that he signed a contract to drive this car for yet another year. There was speculation that he might have tried the Formula One circuits in 1987, but such is not the case. They had a good breakfast, I guess, and he agreed to work for the big money.
Now we're spending a lot of time speculating on how much a 23-year-old gets in Indy racing when he is as competitive as Michael Andretti is and has the name. And were you ever able to find out, Chris?
Well, I know one thing for sure, more than I made when I was 23. And he's back in again. Now that he's got all this money, why hurry?
Well, now they are looking at suspension. So there's some problems there as Michael is in, and they're looking now at the rear suspension. The area, now they drop him down quickly, and they get him right out of there. So whatever they did, it was very superficial. So Michael Andretti is back and racing. He is now in ninth spot. Now down to Jack Arute.
Rick Mears is a DNF here at Sanair. Rick, what put you out of the race?
Oh, but, we had some engine problems, what really put us out. But, you know, the Penske and the Chevrolet were working pretty decent. We had the track conditions changed last night, so we made some corrections overnight. We went too far, and the handling was off, and we were just trying to get it going again, but then had a little motor problem.
What about the problem early today when you had to change the oil line? Could it have been possible that when you were changing that line, you might have knocked the weight distribution out just a bit, and that could account for the problem burning those right front tires?
No, I don't think that would have been a problem. I really don't. You know, just basically the changes that we made overnight, I think we're just too far for the track conditions this morning, and it, you know, that's really what hurt us.
Well, it hurt him bad. He's out of the race, gentlemen.
result, Rick Mears is out. The pole sitter is gone.
Again, that's the fifth straight DNF for the PC15 this year. They've had a lot of trouble developing that new chassis. Right now, we only have two cars in the lead lap. Leader Bobby Rahal in second place, Al Unser Jr., Kevin Kogan, Mario Andretti, Emerson Fittipaldi, all one lap down, along with Johnny Rutherford. But they're going to have to make a stop for fuel fairly soon, too.
Try to open it up a little bit, give themselves a little space. But as you see, car number three there, that's Bobby Rahal's car. Of course, the winner in Toronto, in the inaugural Toronto Indy. And the gap between first and second, between Rahal.
This is a crucial day for Michael Andretti. He's in the pits again for the fourth time today. He's battling his father for the point championship. And this is going to be very costly to Andretti in the season standings, because he's not going to get very many points out of today's competition, no matter how well he drives for the rest of the race. In a sense, he's going to lose ground to his father the way things are going now.
By the way, the point structure, you get a point for being the fastest qualifier and a point for leading the most laps in the race, but you get 20 for winning, 16 for second, 13 for third, 12 for fourth, and 10 for fifth. It goes right down to 20th. You get a point for anything 12th through 20th. But, boy, up on top, you're right. It's going to be a juggling act there, because Mario is on top with 97 points, Sullivan with 96, and Michael with 94. Al Jr., who right now is leading, could move right into the top if he can win this race. He is only 6 points off Mario's lead.
The champion gets a tremendous check at the end of the year, several hundred thousand dollars.
All right, we've got some problems in car number two. That's Roberto Guerrero, who's bent his wing, his rear wing. Is it the rear wing?
Left front wing, I think.
He's damaged a little bit. A slightest amount of contact at the speeds and momentum that you have here can really throw a car off.
Those wings, Ron, are very important to the stability of the car. You can see the left front wing is down. Now, that it changes the airflow over the wing and affects the aerodynamics of the car. These cars have often said to have been airplanes upside down on wheels. The car itself is a wing. They're called wing cars. And the airflow over the car forces it down to the track. If you were to take this car and turn it upside down and shoot it out of a cannon, it would fly.
That's right. We mentioned the fact that at 230 miles an hour or so, you could lift the 747 off the ground. So
exactly.
That tells the story. All right, Jacaroot again.
It seems like when it rains, it pours, especially on Roberto Guerrero. He had the problem when he ran out of fuel. Now the report is that they may have to come in and replace the front wing. It seems that he's damaged one, and he's flying wounded around Sanair. Gentlemen?
Should mention one thing right at this moment. We have lost Jacques Villeneuve. Villeneuve's car was not running very well from the opening of the race. He was in the pits after the first lap. They have now retired the car and pushed it back into the garage area here at Sanair. So Villeneuve is out of the race as we look down at Roberto Guerrero, who currently is in third place. He's a lap down on the leaders, who continue to be Bobby Rahal. Don't forget, they had early pit stops and took on a little fuel as well. And Al Unser Jr. is in second place. I don't know how that's going to affect things when we get down to the end, the staggered pit stops.
It's only time will tell on that one. All right, we're getting the interval here between leader Bobby Rahal and second place Al Unser Jr., and that's almost 7 seconds, 6.58 seconds between the first and second place cars. That's quite a wide margin by Sanair standards.
Gap there you're looking at is car number 30. As we look at the car of Al Unser Jr., he is in third place. He is being chased a little bit there by Roberto Guerrero. Is a lap down on him right now. So basically, we've got those two cars on the front lap, and we're almost sitting here waiting for them to come into the pits so that the whole alignment of the race will get back straightened out. And because of the staggered pit stops, we have had this bit of shuffling, and I think what we have to do is look at 3, 4, and 5 here very closely, because they are very close together. Number 3 in the race right now is car number 2, driven by Roberto Guerrero, and car number 5 is Mario Andretti, who's right with him. And then car number 7, Kevin Kogan. Now, they're together. Now, they are like 3rd, 4th, and 5th, but we must remember that there's going to be a pit stop coming up with cars number 3 and 30, Bobby Rahal and Al Unser Jr.
The pit men are really having the onus put on them now.
So there's Bobby Rahal. There, as you watch him, Rahal, and car number three continues to lead here at the 1986 Molson Indy at Sanair. We'll be back. We have now got an official race here at Sanair. We have passed the midway point. We're actually on lap 118 now of 226. And an official race means if the rains come, it will stop, and it will be declared a race at that point.
Well,
and it's not going to rain, Chris.
No, the sun is out. It's a beautiful day now. Bobby Rahal is running away with this race right now. He has doubled his advantage over second place Al Unser Jr. He's now more than 10 seconds ahead. The last time by, he was doing a great job. But the difference being, Bobby Rahal has had an open racetrack. He's not been concerned with slower cars, while Al Unser Jr. has been wading his way through traffic. That may change once Rahal finds some traffic in his way.
Just through lap 119 now, Rahal has mounted an 8.3-second lead. That's off the official timer. And so he is getting to the point where when his pit stop comes, he is going to not unlap himself or find himself go a lap down and join the others. He could be alone on that lead lap. The others not able to catch up to him while he's in there, provided, of course, that he gets a good pit stop. But his car is racing beautifully right now. You know, he has got a terrific record since he joined the Indy circuit from Formula Atlantic ranks.
Whoops.
And we've got a car, two of them, up against the fence in turn three. A terrific collision up there. You just saw the
Rutherford
debris.
And Guerrero.
And the drivers moving around in the cockpit. A terrific collision up there. It took the front end, as you see, the right front tire of Guerrero's car right off. You can see the mark on the wall, which was caused by one of the tires, I would imagine. Guerrero's getting out. Rutherford is still inside the car. So they came together, and Roberto Guerrero's bad luck and the defending champion as well. Johnny Rutherford out of the race.
Those men in the yellow suits are from the Horton Safety Crew. This is a wonderful organization. They get here, they're paramedics, and they're concerning themselves with, let's take another look at how it's shaped up here.
All right, they don't have a good look at it. It was out of the view. You see the tag end of it. There it is.
Right. There's Rutherford hit the wall, and Guerrero followed him there. They may have come together down lower on the racetrack. I don't know. I saw them as they were halfway across the track. Those walls are unrelenting, very hard, and it looks as though they're having difficulty getting Johnny out of the car. Guerrero's out by himself. There's going to be a long yellow flag here while those cars are removed and the debris is swept up. For those of you who follow Formula One racing, the Grand Prix of Italy at Monza was held today, and the Brazilian Nelson Piquet has taken one. Here's another way, another look at what happened here. And there's Rutherford backing into the wall, and Guerrero coming along. Right, Guerrero hit,
he's already
Guerrero,
lost his
Guerrero hit the fence, hit the wall before he got over to. In fact, they may not have come together at all.
Guerrero may have hit the fence as a kind of a reflexive move. It's hard. It's just speculation. That's all you can do at this stage. We don't have a view of what initiated the problem, and so I think we'll probably have to wait for Jack Arut to ferret out the details down in pit row as to what happened. He'll be down there investigating, of course, causes and effect from there. There's a shot of Johnny Rutherford, Lone Star JR, who was involved in one of the most exciting Indies I've ever seen.
Johnny's had a tough recent years with a lot of crashes. He won the Michigan 500 this year, which was a big boost for his career, a very big boost for Rutherford's career. I don't know whether he's out of the car or not at this point.
All right, as they work on Johnny Rutherford to try to remove him from the car, we can tell you this is the 1986 Molson Indy from Sanair. We'll be back. The cars are on the caution, of course, as they remove Johnny Rutherford's car from the track. That's car number 21, you see, being hoisted away from the wall area. Rutherford is all right. He got out of the car after they released some metal around his legs, and he will, of course, go to the track hospital. So Rutherford is all right. The car is being removed. Roberto Guerrero, of course, got out from without help. His car has already been removed from the track, and the cars continue to move around the track. Under the yellow. Jack Arut's down in pit lane to bring us up to date on the accident.
Here's how close it came for Roberto Guerrero. This is his helmet that he just brought to pit road, and you can see where it's all tore up. Roberto is with us, though, and Roberto, you're okay.
Yeah, fortunately, I'm okay.
What happened?
I think it's, you know, this track is very tight, and I was trying to get by Johnny, and I thought I had the line, and he came across. So, you know, it's just very easy for that to happen on this racetrack, unfortunately.
Well, they say expect the unexpected when you come to Sanair, but nobody expected what we've seen today. Gentlemen?
So Roberto Guerrero has thought he had the line and didn't, apparently. We'll probably get a much different view of it if and when we can get a conversation going with Johnny Rutherford on the subject.
Well, as I said at the top of the show, Rob, this racetrack has one groove in the corners. Only once today has a clean outside pass been made that I've seen, and that was in turn three when we were at commercial with Bobby Rahal, a past driver. It's very difficult to pass in the corners here, and as the race goes on, the drivers become more and more confident, and they think they can do something now that they've been unable to do before, and apparently this is the case here, where these two frontline drivers had their cars come together in a turn, and the damage to these automobiles, and the cost is monumental here. These cars cost over $250,000 apiece, and the accessories are tremendously expensive, and that little crack probably will run over $100,000 in repairs for the two cars.
Well, we continue to operate on the yellow here. The 128th lap has just been passed of 225 here at Sanair, and our leader, and there's only two on the first lap, Bobby Rahal. We'll be back. Johnny Rutherford's car, there's $250,000 worth right there on its way to the junkyard.
You know the blue blanket underneath it? That's interesting. That's a diaper. That's to keep the fluid that are leaking out of the engine from getting on the track and making the track slippery and more dangerous. You can see it there, the blue cloth underneath it. These safety men here in cars really think of everything. 15 of our 21 starters remain on the raceway. Let's get back to that Formula One race we spoke of earlier. The Grand Prix of Italy was held in Monza earlier today. Brazilian Nelson Piquet was the winner over Briton Nigel Mansell. Swedish driver Stefan Johansson was third. K.K. Rosberg was fourth. Gerhard Berger was fifth. And Alan Jones was sixth in the American Ford engine team Haas car. So the point standings get shuffled in International Formula One with the world championship at stake.
It's funny, just before the race, Howdy Holmes, who's not driving, is working for another network here today. We're reminiscing a little bit about the Formula Atlantic days when Howdy was driving very well among the likes of Danny Sullivan and Bobby Rahal and Gilles Villeneuve and K.K. Rosberg, who was also in that series and doing quite well. But none of them could beat Gilles Villeneuve in those days. And so we're, you know, a long way down the road, and that Formula Atlantic series has produced a lot of drivers for European and North American racing.
The difference today, here it is here, the Formula Atlantic, you get a trophy and a hearty handshake. The winner today will get $97,944 Canadian with a almost $80,000 second place run. You can see the money is substantial, $840,000 Canadian dollars at stake in this competition here in the Molson Indy.
$15 million is the total money pool for the year and Indy type racing. It's a terrific series.
Well, you know what's going to happen. If the money keeps going up, these guys are going to be winding up and living in Ibiza and attack Monte Carlo and places where you don't have to pay any taxes.
One more with the pace car out on the track, and then they're going to go back to racing here. Let's update you. The situation as it stands right at the moment is Bobby Rahal on top. 0.6 of a second, of course, he's closed up under the yellow, is Al Unser Jr., and a lap down is Kevin Cogan, followed by Mario Andretti, who was in the pits during this pit stop, or at least during this yellow, and Emerson Fittipaldi currently is fifth. In sixth place is Danny Sullivan. In seventh place, car number 33, that's driven by Tom Sneva. Car number 55, driven by Johnny Parsons, is eighth. And, you know, he's a funny driver, Johnny Parsons. You remember when he drove for Jacques Villeneuve at the Indy 500, when Villeneuve didn't race and he drove the Canadian Tire Team car? He just moved up through the field, and all of a sudden he had a very good finish for the Canadian Tire people. He's a conservative kind of a driver who makes use of the of machinery and the track, as the green flag has been shown, and they are back racing once again, and we've had a shuffle right off the start.
Al Unser is putting the pressure on Bobby Rahal for the lead. In fact, he almost stole it on the restart. So we've got a great battle going on for the number one position here at Sanair. Bobby Rahal of Ohio, with the Al Unser Jr. of New Mexico, and a yellow flag flies yet again as looks looks like getting Firestone maybe over there on the back straightaway.
Right on the between two and three, a car has come to a stop. That's car number 36, and that one belongs to Dennis Firestone, who's had his problems here today.
Now let's watch on this restart when it comes, and it should be very quickly. Al Unser Jr. grew up on oval tracks, dirt tracks, half-mile ovals, where restarts, and here, now they're coming in for their fuel stops now. Ha! We'll see whether Mario Andretti and any other drivers can get their laps back. Routine pit stops for leader Bobby Rahal, second place Al Unser Jr., and Tom Sneva, who's three laps down, also stopped in car 33.
Three new tires for Rahal.
Well, you see, it was very fortuitous for Rahal. He got what he needed without losing anything but maybe 200 yards of racetrack. Al Unser's back on the track, too. But so that puts number seven, Kevin Cogan, in the lead. But it's interesting, I started to say, Al Unser's training in racing was one of never letting an opportunity go by. On a restart, it's easier to pass somebody on a restart by out-accelerating them under slower condition than it is at high speed, which he almost did a few moments ago by Bobby Rahal.
Rahal is there. That's the car you see. And there, of course, is Kevin Cogan's car, number seven. So he is in there. And I think just ahead of him is Michael Andretti's car. So car number 18 there, Michael Andretti. So they are bunched up now under the yellow once again until they get that car and the service truck's out of the way. Dennis Firestone's car has been restarted and he's going to rejoin the back of the pack. So the service vehicles are on the track right now and they have to make their way around to the pit area again. And as soon as that happens, they'll go one more and get the green flag. So we've had a fair amount of racing under the caution or non-racing under the caution here. But when they've been racing, it has been really something. Kevin Cogan there is going to make a pit stop. He's coming in himself.
Okay, and that puts... Who does that put into the lead?
Right now, we still have the car of Al Unser Jr. in front, 37 seconds ahead of Bobby Rahal, but they're on the same... Well, it can't be. They can't be on the same lap 37 seconds back, but this is the way our official timing has it right now.
Well, see, Al Unser is leading, but he's at the tail end of the line. That means all those other guys got to go all the way around to catch him.
That's right.
I find that hard to swallow, but that's
the 37 seconds is because of the slow caution laps right now, which is what is happening. They're much reduced speed, of course, here.
So what we've got here is a tremendous amount of traffic in front of Al Unser Jr.
Pace car did not come off the track, so they're going to go at least one more round.
Danny Sullivan, who we've not heard from much today, a Rick Mears stablemate on the Penske team, has not been having a good day. He's in the pits right now for adjustments to the number four car. He's several laps down. It's been a tough day for the Penske organization. Sullivan had a problem in New York City the other night, driving in a taxi cab, and the taxi cab stopped for a red light. When it started across the street, the driver ran the red light and crashed into the side of Sullivan's taxi cab, threw him against the divider between the rear and the front seats. He got out of his taxi, lay down on the sidewalk, and the doctors came to him, and they said that he needed some stitches. He says, "Don't you touch me. I'm going to my own plastic surgeon." Went to the airport, flew to California, and got himself sewn up. He says, "I didn't want a scar." 25 stitches were taken. He said he feels fine now. Here they come now for the restart. There's our leader way in the back of the field.
And he'll slip right into the traffic there, Al Unser Jr., and they're back racing. The gap right now is going to close right up, but at this moment, as they hit the line, was 38 seconds.
Mario.
The next lap was going to close it right up again, and we'll get a true reading of how close they are. And that's Mario as he's slowing down.
Mario had a lapse there, a power. This car's smoking, and he may be putting oil down on the track. We may see yet another yellow, and that's exactly what we're seeing. And here's Derek Daly got very wide there. Don't know whether he had contact with the outside wall or not, but Mario Andretti's limping in. His right front wing is missing. Mario Andretti on that restart apparently lost his right front wing. Look, his right front wheel is standing still there, skidding to a stop. Now they're going to have to take the nose off and put a new... Watch this pit crew work. Oh, they've got a right front wing ready to put on there.
All right, he touched the wall, I think, as he came off the start. He got a little higher, did he? No, he's down low. Somebody pinched him. That was Michael. Was that Michael's car just in front of him? And it just took the piece off the wing, so...
Yeah, he's going to go without... Now, this is interesting. Mario Andretti's going back out on the track without the repairs having been made. The reason he's going back out is so as not to lose a lap. If this yellow stays out, he'll come back in again for installment two of nose repair. It's like going to a periodontist and they say, you know, we're going to charge you $20,000. We want you to come 20 times at $1,000 a pop. And they do this so they don't lose a lap. He could stay there and gotten the nose fixed, but he would have been another lap down. Now, he'll come in the pits again, perhaps. Not this time. But he's going to be seriously affected handling without the right front wing.
Well, you know, you obviously couldn't drive the car with any speed at all under these circumstances at speed. But Mario right now is ranked fifth, two laps down.
Yeah.
So he does not want to lose another lap. And you've got to remember that points are so important right now. He wants to get the best possible finish, obviously, for money reasons and everything else, but also, he's in first place, but only by a point, so it's a very narrow situation for Mario Andretti.
I can see some arguments being voiced after the finish here with Al Unser being in the lead here way back in the field. But we'll be back for the race after these important messages with Al Unser leading.
Well, they completed the repairs to Mario's car. They have just now got the green flag from the race starter, and they're back racing again, and Al Unser Jr. is in front. And right now, he's got his sights set on Bobby Rahal, because if he can pass Bobby Rahal, he will have lapped the entire field. The remaining 15 cars that are in the race. And that puts him in a very good position. So right now, according to the standings we have, which is a computer readout we get, lap by lap, only two on the lead lap. Leader, of course, Al Unser Jr., and in second place, Bobby Rahal. But he is, at this moment, 21 seconds down. So Bobby Rahal has that car right in front of him. And as I say, he's about to lap the field if he can catch him.
And, of course,
and he's catching him.
Rahal will fight hard to keep that from happening. For if there's another yellow flag, the pace car comes out in front of Al Unser Jr., and lets Bobby Rahal make up 30 of the 37 seconds that he's behind now.
All right, we're going to watch this one now. That, again, is Unser trying to lap the entire field. The last remaining man being Rahal, and he's moved right up now, nose to tail. It'll be interesting to see what Rahal does to try and prevent it.
Well, you know, right, if I were Al Unser, I'd just sit there, knowing he's in second place, and I'd just keep him in sight. I wouldn't risk a dangerous pass. Doesn't pay another dime to lap the field. Winning is what's important.
Of course, we saw that incident last year where Jacques Villeneuve and Rahal were racing for the lead, and a rather foolish moment in terms of timing in the race. Villeneuve tried a pass right at this spot, as a matter of fact, took both cars right out of the race.
75 laps to go. We're exactly at the two-thirds mark.
Exactly
seems to
right.
be constant there, Ron. It looks like Rahal, as we say, is holding Unser.
Well, it is either that Unser is content where he is, or that Rahal is the equal of Unser. The gap continues to maintain itself. We'll review the top five again for you. Just those two cars on the lead lap, 20.6 seconds separating them. That's, of course, Unser Jr. and Rahal. Third place is Emerson Fittipaldi at this moment. Fourth place is Kevin Kogan in car number 7. And fifth place is Danny Sullivan. After him in sixth place is Tom Sneva, who's moved up into the situation, except no sooner did I say that, and he got a stop and go in his own pit.
Unser is wife, lovely gal, Shelly, is with child, and she's an exuberant young thing, and starting to cross her fingers down on pit road now, hoping that Al can see where he is. 70 laps, that's touch and go on fuel, Ron. Whether they'll be able to make it to the end, I really don't know. Look here now, here comes the possible...
Just got a blown turbocharger out in the back. It looks like a turbo to me. That belongs, I think, to Dale Coyne. He just blew it just at the back, and all of a sudden it started to... no, that is not. That is Patrick Carter back there, and he has come in now. And the yellow is out again, and it was like a rooster tail on the back stretch as it blew.
See, this is what Rahal needed, this yellow flag. Now, the pace car comes out in front of Al Unser, and Bobby Rahal goes all the way around the track and gets on the tail end and has a shot at perhaps winning it.
There's Unser.
Now, with 55, 70 laps to go, it may mean that somebody will elect to stop now and top off and have enough to go the rest of the way. Enough fuel, that is.
Pancho Carter, I think they've just packed it in for the day. All right, the pace car is just tucked in now in front of Michael Andretti, Alonso Jr. rather, and that means now that just in front of the pace car, is he going to pass? He's just gone by again.
They've got to tell Bobby to go. Bobby may think he's leading.
Yeah. Well, the pace car is now, and we've got a little bit of a confusion here, because what should happen here is car number three should get in front of the pace car and go around and tag in behind.
Exactly.
And he has not done that. He's tucked in. Now, that may be the official standings.
Well, I questioned the fact
All right.
That,
See, you questioned it, and I think you're right. Yeah. I think that the official standings are the way we're seeing it. Rahal's in front, and so our computers have malfunctioned on us here. There's been a timing malfunction. And I think what we've got now is the official order, and that means we may have a lot of cars on the same lap. Not the way we've been describing it to you.
I think Rahal didn't want to go around, didn't want to admit to being in second place.
All right, we've just lost Pancho Carter in the race, and we hope to go to Jack Arute momentarily. Now hold it. Now Rahal has gone in front of the pace car. So they've waved him by. All right, we've straightened out that. All right, so now we're back to square one. The computers were right. So Rahal's going to tuck into the back of the pack, and we continue to have Al Unser Jr. as our leader right behind the pace car. All right, Jack Arute's ready with Pancho Carter. Jack?
Pancho Carter is out of the race. What put you out, Pancho?
Well, we blew an engine there at the end. We'd had some trouble early on. Had an upright come loose. We had to come in and make a lengthy stop under the green, so we were down quite a few laps, but the five-star marketing car was handling real well, and you know, it's just a shame that I couldn't continue that string of finishes with, you know, another third.
A lot of close quarters action here and a lot of bent fiberglass, busted fiberglass, in fact.
Well, it sure is. It reminds me a lot of the sprint cars and midgets I used to race. Really enjoying myself out there. The car was handling real well, and I was able to work my way back up through traffic, even unlap myself one of the laps we were down, and was going to try and keep doing that until the race was over.
Well, let me update you as well on the situation between first and second, Al Unser Jr. and Bobby Rahal. I conversed with Steve Horn, the crew chief on Bobby Rahal's car, and he was convinced that they were the lead car, and that was the reason why he kept Bobby out behind the pace car rather than picking up the lap. He checked with scoring, and they had told him two different times two different things. So it looks like maybe now, under this caution, it's been straightened out.
All right, I think they straightened it out immediately when they finally waved Rahal by after a great deal of conversation. So it is, Al Unser Jr. leading, and we'll be back. While they clean up Pancho Carter's oil, which is located between 2 and 3 here in this tri-oval at St. P and the Sanair Superspeedway, we can talk a little bit, Chris, about what a victory, if in fact it turns out to be that way, and I don't think we should talk too assuredly of a victory at this stage. So many things happen in this form of racing. But Al Unser Jr., if he wins this, by the way, we've just been told he's going to get a stop and go penalty for whatever effect that will have, and it won't be a great deal with a lap lead.
Maybe Jack Arute can find out why. It may not be anything Al Unser did. It may be an official, a way of getting the standings straightened out. Maybe Rahal is the leader, unless, in fact, Unser did violate some of the regulations during a pit stop. Only time will tell there. Jack perhaps can check that out.
All right, so should Al Unser win this, the 20 points that he would get would give him a total, should he win it, of 111 on the year. It would vault him from fourth right into the lead. Now, Mario Andretti, who is the leader, currently is well back in the pack and a couple of laps down, so he's not really going to do that well overall. He may pick up 6 or 7 points in this thing. Right. But
what it's going to do, Ron, is make a tremendous battle at the top. Now, here down in the pits is Jack Arute.
Steve Horn is the crew chief for Bobby Rahal's True Sports Racing team, and Steve, see if you can unravel this for us. Now, what is Cart telling your team about your position on the racetrack?
Well, Cart have just told us we are the leader, but there's some confusion because they picked up the wrong leader. I think the situation arose under the very second to last yellow. We and Alan Sejunia put it together, but he passed the pace car in the pits exactly as we did in Toronto, and we feel he's due a penalty. And I think that's what Cart's going to do, but they have a slight problem, I think.
So your petition to them is to try and straighten it out before we go back to green.
Right, I want to sort it out before we go green. They have told me we are the leader, but twice in a row now they've picked up the wrong lead car.
Well, that's the story here, but there's still a lot of question marks. Gentlemen?
All right, what's happening, I think, Chris, is the computers are showing that we have this lap advantage that Al Unser Jr. enjoys. And as you look at a close-up shot of Bobby Rahal and his car, I think they're loath to start messing around with that. Yeah. So rather than mess with the computers, I think what's going to happen is that scene, that rather odd scene we had in Toronto where they brought Rahal in and then they just held their hand up, and the steward stood in front of that car until everybody had gone a lap, and then they sent him back out. It drove everybody in the Rahal pit crazy.
Well, here we have a problem is compounded. They picked up the wrong leader, and Al Unser at the same time passed the pace car on the pit lane. The pits here represent about a third of their lap distance. It's pretty hard to come into the pits at any kind of rate if the pace car's out there without passing it, and it can be done very unintentionally. So apparently what they're going to do is just get Al to go back at the end of the line where he belongs. Now, the stop-and-go penalties are usually levied under green flag conditions. They won't do that under the yellow flag because it's really not much of a penalty. Now, once the race is given the green flag, they'll bring him in, and that will be a very costly stop-and-go penalty.
We had what they called a stop-and-go penalty in Toronto, but it was not stop-go. It was stop and stay. And they stayed for almost a minute.
Yeah.
And that's what picked up, I think it was 51 seconds or something that Rahal had to deal with.
The difference between Toronto and Sanair is that in Toronto it took a minute 20 to get around the track. Here it takes 20 seconds to get around the track. So a stop-and-go here would take Al Unser from the front of the pack to the back of the pack. And the third-place car is two laps down. So all it will mean to Al Unser is the loss of a position at best. From first to second.
And we'll then, we hope, have the computers straightened out so that Rahal would be first. Then we would have Al Unser Jr. And in third place, then would be Emerson Fittipaldi, who is in third on our computers as well, but shown two laps down. He would be just one lap down. Well, this is the 98th event in 8-year history of CART since they broke away from USAC and those hardly halcyon days when the war was on between the two governing bodies. And we have had two winners here in Sanair, Danny Sullivan, and then last year with much controversy, Johnny Rutherford, who was passed in a very controversial finish right at the wire by Pancho Carter in caution yellow flag conditions. It took almost 3 weeks to declare a winner last year. We hope we don't have that kind of a situation here. There you see the situation. And we'll be coming back in a couple of moments. They've just dropped the green flag. Little Al Unser Jr. continues to be in front as we race on lap 171 of 225 here at the Molson Indy at Sanair in St. B, Quebec, just south of Montreal. And now an oil flag coming out once again. So some oil has been dumped on the track again. And they're just warning, and I think it's in turn one, just warning the drivers of it. It's a caution flag, but as you look now at the leader right now, that was not an oil flag, that was a blue flag, wasn't it?
Move over flag. They've not given Al Unser Jr. The black flag as yet, and I wonder if they're having second thoughts about that. They're probably reviewing the scoring to make sure they're right this time before they bring him in the pits, because, you know, it's been said that one of the things the crew really needs in big-time racing today, in addition to a mechanic and an engineer, is a lawyer.
Well, Al Unser Jr., I think, would be advised right now to open it up. He's got a lot of open racetrack to work on with right now. You can see he's really moving. And he is going to try and... Kevin Cogan on the outside there. Rahal going underneath him. And they're side by side down the pit straight and into turn one. Rahal takes Cogan. Rahal in second place. Third place is Emerson Fittipaldi, who's not in your picture there. Cogan is in fourth place. And he has just dropped down a lap.
yellow black flag being picked up by starter Nick Fornaro. So if they're going to give Unser a stop and go penalty, the officials down there are wigwagging to the starter some sort of information.
Just saw a shot of Kevin Kogan, who is starting to become a very consistent driver. He has been in the top five three of his last four races, and here he is currently in fourth place. Kevin Kogan, who, as I mentioned at the beginning, was a very controversial individual and has moved and bounced from team to team, apparently has found a home now and is starting to show some of the talents that he demonstrated back in the old Formula Atlantic days.
Well, one thing Kogan has done is has made most of racing off the track. He's a model for a line of clothing, and he has a lot of business connections that racing has given him, something that many other drivers would like to do but have been unable to.
Back early in his career, almost before he got into Indy racing, he had already made a national soft drink commercial that was very successful for him as a model. All right, so all right, now we've got a yellow flag out, and I don't know exactly the reason for that, but they're going to go back into a situation again where they're racing under the caution. And here's Jack Arute downstairs.
You're looking at Steve Horn, the crew chief for Bobby Rahal. You heard him tell us during that caution that Carden informed him that they were the leader of this race. When they restarted it, however, he was in second position. He has now told me that he intends to protest the finish of this race. His blood pressure is awfully high right now.
One could imagine.
Oh, that's right. He's a big guy, and I can see him getting upset, so just forget what we said earlier.
Well,
Al Unser is the leader, apparently, and they're going to leave him there.
Well, Bobby Rahal now, as the yellow flag is out and everything is slowed up, I don't know. I'm looking for a service vehicle. Some paper is dropping down on the track, and the wind is starting to kick up here. And apparently, some debris has gone down on the track. Certainly, it's not the paper, but something has gone down, and they're going to have to pick it up.
In American stock car racing, Ron, when the yellow flag comes out for that reason, it's referred to as the Frenchman is on the track. Huh. Monsieur Debris.
And
it has to be cleaned off. Well, I think that post-race machinations will be interesting with Rahal's crew contending he's the winner and Unser's crew saying it's absolutely not the case. Rahal's luck in Canada has been terrible. Problems in Toronto and now problems here.
Well, don't say that. He met his wife in Canada at Mosport. His first professional race was in Jarvis, Ontario, when he was underaged and lied about his age to get in. But you're right. He's had a difficult 1986, shall we say, in Canada.
Well, racing is showbiz, Rod, and you know how what they say is showbiz. You're only as good as your last show.
So we can tell you that right now, as the pace car has removed itself from the track again, we're going back to racing. Now, this is lap 181 of 225. An eventful day here at Sanair, it has been. And there's lots more to come as, again, Al Unser Jr. opens it up, looking to, if he wins this race, take over the overall points lead. And he has led for a while now. Chasing him there is Michael Andretti, right behind him.
We've got a 3.52-second interval between Unser and Rahal. And we'll see what that reads this time by, whether Al Unser, this clear open track, is pulling away, or is Rahal gaining ground. Number was 3.52 last time by, and this time it's 4.06. So that clear track is what Al Unser needs and likes to build this advantage as large as possible.
Michael Andretti's car, that yellow and blue car, shown second in the picture, is actually seventh place. He is six laps down. That's car number 18. But as you mentioned, Chris, Al Unser Jr.'s car is an easy one to spot, that red, white, and blue.
Ray,
he is out in front, 4.1, it says officially on the computer now, ahead of Bobby Rahal. Emerson Fittipaldi's two laps down and sort of settled into third place ahead of Kevin Kogan. And in fourth place is Danny Sullivan, in fifth place, rather.
You know, in the points, Ron, the Andretti's father and son are next to one another on the track. And
Michael will gain a point or two on his father if they finish this way. And they were 1 point apart, if you remember, going into the race.
And we're looking at our leader, Dale Unser Jr., car number 30. Third last year after starting 15th. 10 times in the top 10 last in 1986. That equals his total of last year. He was fourth in Toronto. He lost a portion of his front wing in that race.
Okay, here.
All right, now he's coming in. Al Unser Jr. is on his way into the pits. Let's see what this pit stop will be. Put a timer on that one.
All right. There he is for the stop and go. Oh, it's more than a stop and go. They're holding him. You see the official standing by the front there? He's out of the picture. If you'd widen out to the right a little bit, you see the official standing there holding him.
Now, this is just a repeat. Now, it looks like it's about... Well, what do we have there, about 10 seconds?
Well, at least Ray Hall has gone by.
11.63 seconds. And now we have the car coming in with another blown engine, it would appear.
Oh, what a break for Al Unser. No sooner than he goes back on the track after being held in the pits. Oil is down. Tom Schneever's engine gave trouble. There's oil on the track. The yellow flag comes out yet again, allowing the field to close up. So Al Unser Jr. will now just be... a matter of a few yards behind Bobby Rahal when they take the green flag once the track is again clear.
All right, so there's Tom Sneva. Gas man, as they like to call him.
The oil man today.
Yeah, the oil man today. And he has dumped a bit on the track, and the yellow flag is out on lap 190. So we have 35 laps to go here at Sanair.
If Jack could check with Sneva's pit, he may have made 10 pit stops so far today. It may be a record, I think, for one driver, number of pit stops. It'd be interesting to know. Sneva obviously is out of it for the day.
And as we now have a reshuffling, we can tell you that Ray Hall is in front, officially. And in second place now is Al Unser Jr. So apparently they have straightened out the quote-unquote controversy, and we'll be back.
It's an amazingly calm Dennis Swan that's behind me. He's the crew chief for Al Unser Jr., who just received what Dennis kindly called the stop and wait penalty. Dennis, it almost seemed like it was Shades of Toronto all over again.
Well, these little short tracks, it's easy to get a little confusion. And basically, we made a really good pit stop in the middle of the race. And we beat the pace car out. And we put a lap on the field, which is probably technically not too cool. So what they did is they waved Bobby around on the next yellow. And so I thought everything was fine, and now they gave us a stop and wait. I don't quite understand it all.
Well, is it a cool move or a not too cool move?
Well, that's a relative.
That's a story from the pits, but they still think they've got a good shot at winning this one.
I would have to think they would have a good shot at winning it. They are very competitive right now, and there's only 3 seconds separating the two of them.
That's right, and the interval is the same as it was when they took the flag, and Al Unser has eliminated one of the cars that stood between he and Bobby Rahal. There were seven cars. He was the seventh in line. He's now the sixth in line, and we'll put our clock on him next time. It was 3:35 last time by, and Al is flying out there. He's got his Albuquerque up, I like to say.
You're looking at Bobby Rahal now, but I think the guy to watch will be the car of Al Unser Jr., because he's going to be flying through traffic. Now, you've got to also remember here, there isn't an awful lot of time left in this race. This is lap 197 right now, so there are only 28 laps left at 20 seconds plus a little bit each lap. So, really, time is of the essence, and little Al is going to really be going to work out there on some slower traffic.
It's amazing. And Al was within 2 1/2 seconds, and now he's 5 seconds behind thanks to the traffic he's involved there. He's involved with Mario Andretti, and he just can't get by. In the meantime, Ray Hall is doing right now what Al Unser was doing just before the yellow, making the most of an open track.
Well, he's going to take advantage while little Al has his problems. Now, he's not even gaining on Mario right now as they try to close it up there. Mario Andretti currently is in seventh place overall. Well, that's the seventh place car he is trying to lap at this moment. Mario's had his problems in the pit, and that's what's done Mario in here. He is 6 laps down. Now it's closed up, but there's a little bit of slower traffic in the person of Kevin Colgan just in front of Mario. So now we get this three-way race here, and there's a three fairly competitive cars, so it's not going to be easy for little Al here.
He's at 6 and almost 7 seconds down now, and there just won't be time. He just can't seem to get by Andretti, and then he's got Hogan in front of him. Would be a tough customer to get by because...
Well, now as we pass the 200 lap mark, there are only 24 laps remaining.
And now Ray Hall, it's Ray Hall's turn to run into traffic. Ray Hall is coming up on a group of three slower cars he's going to have to dispose of. And that will allow Unser to close the interval to some extent.
Right now, the leader then is Ray Hall, looking for another win. A good year. He's had three of them already this year, and he's right now comfortably in front. Of course, the biggest one being the Indy 500, where he's scooted by Kevin Colgan to win. He has 11 career Indy wins. If you take a kind of a line and draw 1982 as your line, only one other driver has recorded 11 wins since 1982. Mario,
really?
So,
well, that's interesting to see. I was going to say Mir.
No, it has been Mario Andretti.
Well, Mario is really a racer in every sense of the word. He has the appetite for the cut and thrust, and he likes the road courses, the super speedways, and the short ovals as well. Ray Hall, his training has been in road racing.
That's right. He's come along so well in this sport, in the oval-type racing. One thing I started to... Everybody says that Ray Hall's a good second-half driver. Go for the championship, he's good at it. So I went back last year to the second half and took his victories, because he's had a pretty good start to this year, too, counting the Indy 500. He has won 6 of the last 17 kart races, which is a terrific percentage when you think about it. He has been really the dominating force in kart racing.
He had an emotional setback this year when his car owner, Jim Truman, passed away shortly after the Indianapolis 500, and Truman's widow and his companies have decided to stay in racing and keep this car on the track for Ray Hall. And it's quite a sentimental situation in the pits around that car.
I can remember going back to the Formula Atlantic days here in Canada, Chris, and that sleek Jeep and the red roof ends was on those cars back in those days. Jim Truman was with him from the very beginning. It was a wonderful and very close relationship between owner and driver that stayed right into Indy racing.
Another thing that Ray Hall has had change in his family life is he and his wife weren't able to have children. And they adopted an infant earlier this year, and he's become quite a family man. He rushes home and spends time with his baby daughter, Michaela.
Well, there you see him, Bobby Ray Hall, who is in his own bit of traffic right now. So this may, well, he got by it very,
Johnny
very
Parsons,
quickly.
Yeah.
Johnny Parsons driving the car normally driven by Jose Legarza.
Garza, incidentally, I'm told by his crew, who suffered a broken thigh at Mid-Ohio 2 weeks ago, or last Sunday, in fact, was released from the hospital this morning and has started therapy. And can you believe this, Ron? A broken thigh. And the car owner says they expect him to be back in the car racing in Michigan on the 21st of September.
Well, if Rick Mears can come back from the terrible crash that he had here at Sanair 2 years ago and race within, 7 months? He had terrible injuries. He still pays the price for those injuries. That's amazing.
You know, it's interesting, the Rick Mears accident here in Sanair has had a dramatic effect on the track itself. There were steel guardrails along the inside of the front row at that time. Now you notice there's cement guardrails. So were that accident to happen again, that type of injury would unlikely result.
Bobby Ray Hall currently has got more money earned than anybody on the Indy circuit. But he is fifth in point standings. Now, the reason he's got more money earned is he picked up $500,000 at Indy. That tends to balloon your money earnings rather rapidly. He has $897,000 earned. He'll pick up close to $100,000 Canadian here if he can continue on in the lead.
If he has a good last part of the season, he could run his winnings to $1 million prior to the point fund distribution at Miami in November.
And that would be a first.
Yeah. A lot of traffic here on the main straightaway. Getting tense down there. Several cars in close quarters there. Several cars.
Unser right in the middle of that group there as they slip through. Unser, again, that readily visible red, white, and blue car.
You know
last
what?
In your picture there.
Well, Ron, Ray Hall's having a clean track has allowed him to move up almost within sight of Alan Jr. He may lap Alan Jr. if he keeps going the way he has, but there's 10 laps to go. He's going to have to go some to do that.
Well, it's only 4 seconds separating him because we're dealing with about a 21-second lap, and right now the gap between Ray Hall and Unser Jr. is 17.5 seconds. So, yes, you're right. It could happen if he, in fact, wants to do it. Ray Hall right now has got his eyes set on Emerson Fittipaldi. Fittipaldi is third right now, a lap down, and could go two laps down and join Kevin Cogan two laps down. Cogan is in fourth place. Just quietly going around and around is Danny. Fittipaldi just went by Ray Hall, and Ray Hall just went right back by him. So,
right.
Going to work on Ray Hall. He's more interested now in getting a good third, solid third place finish out of it and end the rather nasty streak for him in which he's been unable to pick up points.
He's been doing great when the car lasts. This will be an important finish for Emerson Fittipaldi, whose car owner just renewed his sponsorship with the Marlboro people for the 1987 season with Fittipaldi to stay at the wheel.
Seven laps to go now for Bobby Ray Hall. He's that close. Ray Hall, who I mentioned was fifth in the standings, should he pick up the 20 points, which would bring him up to 96 points, and he would get into the fight at the top end of the standings. The gap is now 19.3 seconds, and I think we're going to see a nose-to-tail kind of situation here between the two of them. Well, there they are.
Unser just got by Ed Pinn or Derek Daly and Mario Andretti has been able to pull up a little bit. He was stuck back there for many laps. So Ray Hall is straight away behind him now, but there's a lot of cars in between Ray Hall. Four cars between Ray Hall and the number 30 car driven by Alan in second place.
Well, we're on lap 120, or so 220 rather, and that means five laps left now in this 225 lap race, 300 kilometers here at Sanair near Montreal.
How many days was it, Ron, before we knew the winner of last year's race?
3 weeks.
Well, it may be the same today when they go to the judges' chambers on this one.
If I'm Bobby Ray Hall, maybe I do lap him.
Yeah, that's right. To get that extra distance.
Get that little extra distance.
Yeah.
He's moving right in there now. That's Michael Andretti up high, and he has scooted right below two cars and whipped around on one corner, and now he has got the length of the back stretch around through two, the difference between Ray Hall and the second place car, that lapping that second place car of Alan Jr. Bobby Ray Hall now, that's about the only thing to be decided outside of just keeping his car together. But at this point, they start to hear the little twitches.
Right, all the noises there.
Every strange little noise now becomes a can't be my engine going.
Worrisome and expensive noise.
Got a car slowing up on the back stretch right now. But I think he's going to coast all the way around.
There's the white flag. We're on the final lap. Bobby Ray Hall has taken the white choke from starter Nick Fenoro.
Well, Bobby Ray Hall now can coast to victory. For Bobby Ray Hall, with the white flag out, is on his way to his fourth victory. And now no other driver has won more than two this year. Bobby Ray Hall is about to win his fourth of the 1986 racing season. The checkered flag, and he has won it. The third edition of the Molson Indy at Sanair has been won by Bobby Ray Hall. His fourth victory of the year. What a terrific year he is having. And it is far from over yet. Bobby Ray Hall, who won the inaugural Toronto Indy, passing Danny Sullivan to win that. He also won at Mid-Ohio for the second straight year. And, of course, Indianapolis. So today, Bobby Ray Hall picks up his fourth victory of the year, brings his point total to 96 points. And Bobby Ray Hall now is in the thick of the standings for the 1986 CART Championship. Our congratulations to Bobby Ray Hall. We'll be back in a moment.
And wish you could be here, but we'll be home tonight to party.
Looked like shades of Toronto all over again, but with a little different twist.
Well, when I saw him beat the pace car, I said to Steve, hey, that's what I got caught for. I hope they're going to do something about that. And then for a while, I thought, God, you know, it didn't look like they were going to do anything. And You know, Nell's a good friend of mine, but, you know, that's war, I guess, isn't it?
Well, now, the story that we're receiving preliminarily is that you are tied for the points chase right now. You're on top. How do you feel about that?
Well, you know, as I've said all along, we've got to try to go out and win every race, and if we can do that, the championship will take care of itself, and certainly we're on the way now, but I can tell you, if we are first, it's a lot nicer than being sixth.
Hey, for the viewer, it looked like a real heart stopper. How about inside the cockpit of the car? Was it a tough afternoon, or was it fairly easy going for Bobby Rahal?
Well, I had a bit of a misfire at the start, and everybody jumped me, but the car absolutely handled beautifully all day long. The Budweiser car, you know, it was a little slow off the corners engine-wise, response-wise. We richened it up because of the cold weather, and I think that hurt it a bit, but I'm telling you, I could outhandle anybody anywhere.
For those of you that have followed the run of Bobby Rahal, you have always run terrifically the last four or five races. How does that make you feel in the chase for the championship?
Well, I hope it continues. I hope it continues.
Well, that's the story from Victory Lane. Let's go topside.
All right. We can bring you up to date on the standings right now. And because of his fifth-place finish, Danny Sullivan has taken over the points lead in the standings. Sullivan finished in fifth place and picked up 10 points because of the fifth. It gives him now 106 total points. He is alone and 4 points ahead of Mario Andretti, who wound up in eighth place today, and Michael Andretti, who finished in sixth place. They each now have 102 points. They are 4 points behind Danny Sullivan. Now, moving up into fourth place is Al Unser Jr. He finished second, picked up 16 points. He has a total now of 107. My addition was wrong. So let's, all right, we'll correct that because now with my addition corrected on a quick addition, Al Jr. is now in first place, followed by Sullivan, a point back, and then Andretti, both of them at 102, and Bobby Rahal with the 20 points has leaped from 86 to 106 points. So it's now a real dogfight with a single point separating one, two, three drivers. Well, so it's really something.
Of course, and that, of course, is subject to change after the Unser protest is adjudicated.
And we also should mention that there will be, for laps led, there will be a single point for the car that leads the most laps. Rick Mir picks up the point for the pole position, but and there will be adjudication. But as you say, it's a very complicated system, and when they finally get the points straightened out, we'll have a new leader, I think, in the whole overall kart structure. But basically, we've had quite an afternoon here. They always talk about this track and how short it is and how difficult it is in, and the drivers then go out and put on a terrific show.
Well, you know, and each year the crowd gets larger. The crowd gets bigger and bigger every year. Well, we wondered about Al Unser's feelings here. Jack Root is down in the pits with our second-place driver, Al Unser Jr. We got to get the microphones working around. It'll be interesting to hear Mr. Unser's opinions of his stop-and-stay penalty. Stop and go, it used to be stop and then move out right away. the official that's assigned to stand in front of these cars and hold these guys has to be a brave one, I'll tell you, because these guys have an itchy clutch foot. They're revving the engine and screaming and wanting the guy to get out of the way, and those 10 seconds seems like an hour or so. So despite his second place finish, Al Unser is in the lead with the points. Rahal will probably get the point for the most number of laps led, which then would tie him with Unser for the lead with 107 points if no changes are made by the officials based on the protest that Unser's Domino's Pizza crew will file. Okay, now apparently we've got young Al Unser ready to speak with us, so Jack Root is down in the pits with the second place finisher, Al Unser Jr.
Well, Al Unser Jr. is on his way to the victor's podium, but to stand in second place, kind of a bitter pill?
Well, yeah, it is. You know, we don't know exactly what happened. They just, Cart decided to rule me doing wrong somewhere, somehow, so I don't exactly know what's going on yet, and, you know, we had a good car. Bobby did a super job. He was handling real good. It seemed like when I got behind him, I couldn't pass him at all. But I think if he was to be behind me, he wouldn't be able to pass me either. So the air really messed up the car. When you're free by yourself, it really worked good. So You know, I don't know. We'll find out later what Cart has to say. And, you know, I just want to thank Domino's Pizza, Team Sherson, for doing a great job.
Well, no, despite the fact that you don't have a victory this year, this guy is also right up there in the points chase. That's got to at least make you feel good.
Yeah, it does. You know, it just shows that the team is doing a great job preparing the car, because I've finished all these races, and that's the only reason why I'm at the points where I'm at. And so...
Well, that's the story from Al Unser Jr. Finished his second after he thought he had a good chance at winning.
Well, down on the podium right now, they are starting to hand out the award. So let's go down for the ceremony here at Sanair.
Jr. Here he comes, Al Unser Jr. Excellent course. Second place, deuxième place, Al Unser Jr. Qui a été pénalisé d'un arrêt au puits de ravitaillement, comme vous avez probablement pu le voir, sinon il serait peut-être sur la plus haute marche du podium. Et en première position, vainqueur des 500 000 d'Indianapolis, et il atteint presque le million de dollars en gains pour 1986 jusqu'à maintenant, et il reste encore cinq courses. Bobby Rahal, the winner. Et encore une fois, c'est une course qui aura donné beaucoup d'émotions aux spectateurs. C'était la troisième édition. Et encore une fois, on les applaudit bien fort. Troisième place, Emerson Fittipaldi. Deuxième place, Al Unser Jr. Et le grand vainqueur, Bobby Rahal. Alors voilà, qui complète cette troisième édition du Molson Indy. On vous invite donc l'année prochaine. Et on va peut-être demander à faire quelques entrevues avec... Aimeriez-vous entendre le vainqueur?
So the ceremonies continue here at the Molson Indy. Our congratulations again to Bobby Rahal, and we'll be back.
It was a tactical race, eh?
Well, the celebrations continue here at the Molson Indy at Sanair. We can give you the top eight unofficially. Bobby Rahal, the winner. Al Unser Jr. was second. Emerson Fittipaldi of Brazil moves into third place. Ends a bit of a dry spell for him. He'd gone five straight races without picking up any points. Kevin Kogan winds up in fourth place. Danny Sullivan in fifth place. Michael Andretti wound up sixth. Johnny Parsons in the car normally driven by Jose Legarza. He stayed out of trouble all afternoon. He winds up in seventh place, and Mario Andretti in eighth. So Rahal, with his fourth victory of the year, wins the race, and that, of course, sets up a standing situation now where we have Al Unser Jr. on top by... Or he's on top, we know. We don't know who led the most laps. We haven't had that official yet. It could be Bobby Rahal. If that's the case, there would be a two-way tie for first place between Unser Jr. and Rahal. Danny Sullivan is 1 point behind them now, and then the two Andrettis, who would be 5 points off the lead. Michael Andretti and Mario Andretti now tied with 102 points. So don't forget, of course, that Mario went into today's race as the points leader by just a single point over Danny Sullivan.
I tell you, for those who look at things mechanical involved with this form of racing, Ron, the March cars did very well. The Lolas were second and eighth, the rest are Marches. But more importantly, the Cosworth engine prevails as the predominant power plant. The Chevrolet engine, the PC15, did not finish. And the Honda, the lone Honda engine in the competition, also went out early. So it's Cosworth on top again. And the newcomers, from an engine standpoint, are having their problems in making a reliable engine to come up against the British-made Cosworth.
You know, we keep seeing that, don't we? We see people come in with the new Buick engine. We heard about that. Then the Chevrolet engine was going to take over, and the Eagles were going to take over. And the Cosworth just continues to go along and continues to be the dominant engine.
Well, it's interesting. You can bet your life that Roger Penske, who's masterminding that Chevrolet engine, that PC-15, Roger is as persistent as a bulldog, and he's not going to give up. He is determined to make that engine and that car into a winner. It's a fifth straight DNF for that PC-15 with the Chevy engine. Okay, Jack Arut, our pit colleague, is standing by in the pits once again.
Jack Arruda has had an opportunity to take a look at the whole pit scene for us. So here, once again, Jack Arruda.
You know, this year has been a milestone in Canadian auto racing. What with the successful initiation of the Toronto Molson Indy, the unprecedented crowds, and the high caliber of competition. All of us associated with the Molson Indy would like to say thank you to the drivers, their pit crews, their sponsors, and all those who helped make the two stops for the IndyCars in Canada truly world-class events. As you can see, the victory celebration is just about concluded here for the winner of the Molson Indy, Bobby Rahal. I think it's kind of unique that Rahal was the victor in both Canadian races this year, and he's on a roll. The fact that he's tied with Al Unser Jr. for the points chase and the way he runs the last few races year after year in the CART PPG IndyCar Series, he could well be on a roll to his first IndyCar championship. Let's go topside now to Ron.
All right, thanks very much, Jack. And, of course, that now is 7 wins in the last 17 Indy kart races for Bobby Rahal. That is a terrific record, and clearly he is the dominant driver in the kart circuit right now. So, again, our congratulations to Bobby Rahal. We'll be returning in a moment. We mentioned that Bobby Rahal had won 7 races over the last year, basically, the last 18 kart races. That is 38% of the races. Chris, a terrific percentage. He is, you see every race and you report on this all of the time. I can't remember anybody doing as much in such a short period, because there's so much luck comes into this game. He seems to be able to balance the ability to go fast with the ability to keep his machinery together, which is probably a key to winning that many races.
Well, there's another side to that too, Ron. When Rahal came into IndyCar racing, he was an outlander. He didn't know any of the drivers. He didn't know their styles and their nuances. And now that he's more familiar with who he's racing with, he can do better against them, and he's becoming more accustomed to oval track racing, for example. That was really alien to Bobby Rahal, who was essentially a road racer at heart. So the longer he stays, the better he gets at this particular form of racing.
We talk about the advantage that a Rahal has over some of the others when he goes onto the road circuits. We should look ahead. Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin, Road America, as they call it, is a terrific road racing course, and Bobby Rahal has done very well there. They're going to be racing there on the 13th leg of the 17-race series in 2 weeks. Then they go to an oval, back to the International Speedway at Michigan for the 250-miler there, but then another road circuit at Laguna Seca in California. And then Phoenix for the oval. That's a tight oval. Yeah. And then the final race will be the Indy Challenge at Miami, at Tamiami in Miami. So Bobby Rahal's got a very solid shot, I would have to think, at winning the overall championship this year.
That's right. Three of the five remaining races are Rahal's kind of race.
We talk about Bobby Rahal. I think that in the minds of everybody in racing, the two Canadian races excepted, and of course he has won both of them this year, we have to look back at the Indy 500, that exciting last two-lap charge that he made to win after, of course, a yellow that was called in the late stages of the race. Let's look back a little bit right now to the Indy 500 and the excitement of one of the most exciting finishes, I think, in the history of the Indy 500 because of that yellow flag that set the stage for the finish. So let's look back now. Indy 1986.
I knew that my best chance
would be to not necessarily jump him, but get through four with him where I could get up in his draft. And if I could do that, then I figured we could, providing he didn't weave all over the road, I figured, you know, we had a shot at it. And I think my car was handling better anyway, because coming off of four, he really went wide. I mean, I think, I don't know if he had to get out of it, but it must have been close. And because we were going just a little bit slower than normal speed, the turbulence off his car wasn't so bad that I couldn't get up underneath him through the corner. And of course, we were able to get in the draft and draft past him. And I knew that if I could get through one, I knew he'd be close to me through one, but I thought if I could really get through two well and open up enough of a lead where he couldn't get in my draft, then that providing nothing happened to the car, the race would be ours.
And of course, the celebration started then and has been going on all year for Bobby Rahal. Today, his fourth victory. Nobody has more than two besides Bobby Rahal in 1986. We'll be back in a moment.